book of Deuteronomy, and tonight we're going to be in the 29th chapter of the book of Deuteronomy. And, you know, we're coming to the end of the book. We got a few more chapters left. It's amazing, huh? That's amazing. And Deuteronomy, God has been really good to us with this book. You know, Deuteronomy is the last book of the Torah. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. It's the last book of the Torah. Moses is the one who wrote the five books of the Torah, the five books of law. And in Deuteronomy is when we're going to see, this is Moses' farewell speeches to his people. And he is going to go up upon a mountain. He's going to see God, and God is going to bring him to glory at the age of 120 years. Amen. It says that his strength was always with him. His eyesight never grew dim. Amazing, huh? We prayed for some of that tonight. If he can do it for a 120-year-old man, he can do it for us. Yeah, we'll take it. So here they are. They're in the plains of Moab. They're east of the Jordan. They have not yet crossed the Jordan into the Promised Land. They have not yet. They have not yet encountered any battles. The first battle when they crossed the Jordan, some of us know it's the famous Battle of Jericho, where they walk around the city for 7 days in silence. Remember that? They have not yet, and transition has not yet happened from Moses to the new leader, Joshua. It's going to happen soon, within the next few weeks, but not yet. Not yet. Moses is still in charge. And here, Moses wants to do this in tonight's work. He wants to get this new generation to enter into the covenant that the old generation entered into at Mount Sinai, or at Horeb, same mountain. And here they are in the plains, the pleasant plains of Moab, and Moses wants to take his family, he wants to take the Israelites, and he wants to cause them to enter into covenant once again, to renew their dedication to God. And before he does that, he gives them a full view of all of the mighty deeds that God had done over the last 40 years. He calls them to remembrance. Remember the subtitle or the title of the book, it's Never Forget, right? And Moses wants to bring them to remembrance of all of the mighty deeds and mighty acts that happened for these 40 years. Because sometimes we forget how good God is. And then after he reminds them, then he calls them to enter into the covenant and to renew their dedication to God once again. So let us read, everybody. It's the 29th chapter. We'll start with you, Pastor Dad. Let's go through the room and let's read the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Lord done so to this land.
Then the anger of the Lord was aroused against the land to bring it on every curse that is written in this book. And the Lord uprooted them from their land in anger, in wrath, and in great indignation, and cast them into another land, as it is this day.
Amen, everybody. The word of the Lord. I want to thank God because he's been very good to us in opening up this book. And even in the 29th chapter, there's some marvelous things here, I think, that God wants to show us and bless us with. You know, you start from the very beginning. There's two distinct times that Moses is speaking of. The very first thing that he says to them, I think this is probably his last speech to them in regard to the law. He says, "These are the words of the covenant which the Lord commanded Moses to make with the children of Israel in the land of Moab, beside the covenant which he made with them in Horeb." Two distinct times, 40 years between these two times. The first time, it was a different generation. Moses was 80 years old, and he had the children of Israel that just came out of the land of Egypt, and they were out Mount Horeb. And if you remember Mount Horeb, you can remember it because you were there, believe it or not. At Mount Horeb is when they had just been delivered from the Egyptians. Do you recall the story? The Egyptians were chasing them, and they were so scared. Do you remember? They were scared to death. They had the Red Sea in front of them and the Egyptian army behind them. They had forgotten the power of God they saw in Egypt, and they were scared to death. And by a miracle of God, the Red Sea opened. Not only did they pass over on dry land, what else happened? The whole Egyptian army was swallowed up by the sea. Okay. So they get to Mount Horeb. You think they'd start to settle down a little bit, but they were just as scared. They were scared of everything. They were scared of the Egyptians. They were scared of God. They were scared of their own shadow. They were a fearful people because God had just delivered them from Egypt, or hell, if you will, or the world, whatever terminology you like to use. So God is developing this nation. He's doing something new in their life. But at Mount Horeb, you see a people who has been delivered out of something. They were delivered out of bondage. They were delivered out of Egypt. We could even say they were brought or escaped from hell itself. And they had not yet discovered who their God was because their first encounter of their God left them trembling and fearful so much they said, "We don't want to talk to him." You ever feel like that sometimes? Sometimes I felt like that. I don't want to talk to God today. And Moses made the first covenant there. There is an absolute covenant. And God did something spectacular with Israel. We talk about it today. The world still makes movies in regard to it. He delivered them from Egypt. The mighty acts, the 10 plagues. Do you remember the 10 plagues that God sent on Egypt? Mighty acts. God showed how powerful he was. And this is something tremendous that God had done, but it was all in regard to what he was delivering them out of. And now at Moab, God is not delivering them from hell anymore. They're not in the mountain that's on fire just being delivered from the Egyptians. They are on the peaceful plains of Moab. They are relaxed. They probably have a lemonade in their hand. There's probably a cool breeze coming through the land. They're reclining in the grass, and Moses is preaching to them. It was a conference. It was a 30-day conference. It was 30 days. What an entirely different setting. Because there's different times in your life and my life. There's times when God is delivering us from something. And God shows himself to be mighty and powerful when he delivers us from something. Has God ever delivered you from something? a certain addiction, a certain, I don't know, a situation, a certain relationship, a certain something, a certain hell, if you will. Has God ever delivered you from something? And you found that God was powerful enough to deliver you from your hell? Yes, amen to that. That was Mount Horeb. But then they go through this wilderness of sin, if you will, for 40 years. And now God is not delivering them from something. He is about to do something beautiful in their life. And I think that's where we are today. I think God is about to do something beautiful in our lives. He wants us to enter in, not to exit hell, if you will, but now he wants us to enter heaven, a certain paradise, a certain land of promise that maybe you have longed for or desired. Maybe it's just a desire to feel close to God again. Does anybody ever desire that? Sometimes I desire that. I can remember, and I think everyone in this room can remember a point in their life where they felt so close to God. I can. I have a certain time in mind. I remember 25 years ago, I remember the house I was, the study that I had, and the experience I had with God. And it was tremendous. And some of you have had experiences like that in your past. Real times of closeness to God. But then it seems as if as life progresses, there are times you might, as I think God works in this matter, where you go through like the desert wanderings, if you will. You wonder where God is. It's dry, you know. It's like I was so close to God. I felt so mighty, so powerful. And it's like you feel lost. You feel like you lost God. Like God, you can't even explain what you're experiencing or going through. Like, where is my powerful God? Him and I used to be so close. Anybody? And I believe that's this book here, and I believe that now we are on the precipice of entering into something great. I believe that God said he's going to do something greater than he did in the past. Whatever your past experience was with God, he says he's going to do something greater still. And I think the picture here is exiting hell and entering into heaven, and there's like a chasm in between, if you will. There's wilderness wanderings. The gospel speak of this chasm that exists between heaven and hell. It's a certain time period, if you will, a certain wandering, a certain experiencing God. Is there any witnesses in the house? I don't know. Yeah. And I think that God has delivered us from a hell, and that's beautiful, but God says, that ain't all. I'm going to put you into something more than you ever could have imagined. You think delivering you from hell was something, that's was just the beginning. He was just preparing to cause you to enter into heaven, where you're not chasing anything, but you're running from anything. You're actually running towards something. And you're ready. You know God. It's like God and you are one again. You're not afraid of God. You and God are one. It's like, okay, let's go conquer the world, which is what they were about to do. So turn your page with me what did I do here? Okay, that verse there, 29, verse 29, the secret things belong to the Lord. That's going to be Sunday morning. Come back Sunday morning. We'll talk about the secret things. That's why I put that there. You need a hook, right? I need a hook to get you back on Sunday. All right. So that's not for tonight. Verses 2 to 4. Okay, now verses 2 to 4. Let's see. Let's turn your page again. It says in these passages here, this is beautiful. Moses called all of Israel and said to them this, you have seen all that the Lord did before you. This is what we talked about. All the Lord did before your eyes in the land of Egypt to Pharaoh and to all of his servants in the land. And the great trials which you have seen and which your eyes have seen, the signs and those great wonders. There is a yet. It's interesting. It says, the Lord did not give you a heart to perceive and eyes to see and ears to hear to this very day. I think God is saying a couple of things to us. I think number one, which I kind of like, I think he's saying, you ain't seen nothing yet. That's what I think he's saying. You think you saw power. You think you saw glory. You ain't seen nothing yet. You saw God in a place where you were fearful and didn't know him. Now you know him. You ain't seen nothing yet. I'm going to do something marvelous. You're not going to be running from your enemies. You're going to be chasing them. You're going to be destroyed. As a matter of fact, This passage is so fascinating because Moses never talks about the battles. They were about to confront the seven mightiest nations upon the face of the earth, and Moses doesn't even talk about them. How about that? How about that? You want to show that certain things have no power in your life? Don't even talk about them. You mean nothing. Sometimes we're all worried and fearful, and a new word we have for fear is stress, just so you know. Stress is just a new word for fear. We call it stress because then it's acceptable. It's fear. And, you know, we have these things in our lives, but God says this. He says, what does he say, everybody? Help me out. What does he say? He says, you don't even have to worry about it. All Moses talked to them was about their relationship with God. He didn't mention one battle, as if the battles were already won. Now, they were going to have to confront some things in life, but there was no power to them. And may that be your freedom and my freedom. Sometimes we're so occupied, we're talking about, come on now, just seriously. We're talking about all these things. I hear it all day long. We're talking about all these things. All of our lacks, all of our wants, all of our needs, all of our hurts, all of our pains, all of our enemies. Moses didn't talk about them. He paid them no attention. He didn't mention one of them. Moses didn't mention one of them. All Moses talked about was God. He didn't talk about their lack of money, their lack of health, their lack of strength, their lack of wisdom, their lack of relationships, their lack of joy. He just talked about God. Because everything else had no power. It was already destroyed, defeated. Amazing, isn't it? This was a brand new people 40 years later. A brand new people. But I believe God said, you ain't seen nothing yet. But I think he said something else also with this. Look in your passages there. Mark 12, 24. Does anybody who hasn't read want to read Mark 12, 24? In this passage, Jesus is talking to the religious leaders, Pharisees, Sadducees, whomever. Not only were they religious leaders, these were the guys that had the entire law memorized. You know that, right? Things were passed down in ancient days through oral tradition. There wasn't written tradition, not for quite some time. It was through oral tradition. They memorized the Torah. And they passed it down. It was oral tradition. And a lot of these stories, like Moses and whoever, they told stories around the campfires, if you will. There was no books to read. They were great storytellers. Moses was a great storyteller. He wasn't reading a book. He was telling a story. And these men, they had the Bible memorized more than you and I could ever imagine. And Jesus tells them this. He says, you don't know the scriptures, nor the power of God. And then somebody read that next passage, John 5, 37 to 40. Isn't that fascinating? He says, you know the scriptures. That was their only boast in life. The only boast they had in life was that they knew the scriptures. That was their primary boast. And Jesus comes and says, you don't know the scriptures. That's all they knew. That's what they were born for. And Jesus says, if you knew them, you would know who I am. And you would know why I am. But you don't know them. And I believe what God is saying here and God is saying there in Deuteronomy and what God is saying to you and I, he's opening up our eyes to say this. He says, I am all around you. God is saying, I am the biggest thing in your life. And you don't see me and you don't hear me and you don't understand me. But it's okay. It's okay. This is not condemnation. This is God saying, it makes no difference what you see, feel, hear, admit, hate, like, dislike. It makes no difference. He is the absolute source of all of your life. He is in front of you and he is behind you. He is the voice within your heart. He is the direction. He is the one that gets you up in the morning. He's the guy that got you here. He's the one that got you to work. He's the one that lets you live this to this age. I don't know how much longer you got, but he lets you live so far. He is the one. And what he has said to the Israelites in the wilderness was this. You didn't even see God. God was so big and so powerful all around you. He was a sustaining force in your life. And all we could see in our life, all we can see in our life is our lack, is our worry, is our need. We don't even see the absolute power of God. We don't even see the God in human form that stands before us on a daily basis. We say, God, where are you? He appears in flesh and blood, and he stands before you on a regular basis. And he takes different forms. Sometimes he's the gardener, and sometimes he's the cook, and sometimes he's the cashier, and sometimes he's the bus driver, and sometimes it's your son and your daughter and your mother, but you don't see him. He says, I am the form that is before you, speaking words of life into you, but you don't see me and you don't know me. He says, it's okay, but I just want you to know. I just want you to know. And even Moses, God told Moses before he sent him, he said, Moses, you're going to be me. You will be me, is what he said. You will be as God to Pharaoh. You are going to be my physical form upon the earth. And even if the Israelites thought they had an invisible God, that they had to build one out of gold or a golden calf, they had Moses. And Moses was God's physical form upon that earth. He was the faithful one. They saw people dying all around them. The whole generation had to die. There had to be millions that died for 40 years. But there was Moses. Amen. Faithful Moses. Faithful Moses. Whether they wanted to see him or not, he was there. They probably got tired of seeing his face. My mother left me. My father left me. My grandfather left me. And here you are, Moses. God is all around you. And I do believe that what God wants to do through this passage is this. He wants you to begin to see his form in the bus driver, in the cashier, in the angel that he sends. Oh, my goodness. Can I get a witness from somebody? He wants you to hear his voice. He wants you to understand what he's doing in your life. And then he goes on with all of this. And then Moses says, let me show you some of the things that you really didn't see and that you really didn't hear. And in verses 5 to 8, he talks about some of the new mercies that God had done and some of the old mercies that God had done. In verse 5, it says, first of all, verse 5 is very important. It says, and I led you for 40 years in the wilderness. These 40 years, they're called, in the book of Numbers, it's called the wilderness wanderings. Not the wanderings, the wanderings. Although they wandered an awful lot, I know. But they were called the wilderness wanderings. It seemed as if they were lost for 40 years. It says here that God led them in the wilderness for 40 years. They marched around that mountain for a year or so. They went round, around, around. How do we get out of this circle? They went around that mountain for a year. You know, in life, our wilderness wanderings, God is so big and powerful. He's all over, and he wants to show us that he's all over. When you are lost in your life, when you are confused and you can't see the light of day, when you don't know where God is, he is the one that's leading you in your lostness. You think you're lost, but you're not lost. He is leading you. He's leading you from your one blind point to your other blind point. I know you can't see a thing, but God brought you there. I know you're blind and lost and confused and wandering, but he isn't. He is your leader. He led you in your wandering. He wanted you to wander and be confused, but there was absolute order in your chaos. When you thought God was nowhere, when you think or you thought that you left God for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, he led you from point A to point B to point C to point and here you are today. Ah, look at that. You weren't so lost after all. You got to your destination. It's just that God had to go around the mountain because he was doing some things in your life. We say, I backslid. I don't want to hear that nonsense. It's just nonsense. Listen, man, God is doing something in your life, okay? He's doing something. For the last 5, 10, 15, 20 years of your life, he was working something, and he had to do it in the wilderness. And now he's ready to do something spectacular in your life. Now, you call it your confusion, your wanderings, but God did lead you. And then he goes on to say, this is interesting. He says, your clothes have not worn out, and your sandals have not worn out. Has anybody ever read that before about the children of Israel? This scripture here says that for 40 years, their clothes didn't wear out. Now, the only one I know who has clothes that are 40 years old is my father. And they look as good as they did when he bought them. I've sometimes complimented him on his shoes, like, those are nice shoes. Are those new? He says, Mike, they're older than you. Now, there's an act of God. Now, this is what I believe. I think that God wants to see two things. Did they actually have clothes that did not wear out for 40 years and shoes that did not wear out for 40 years? I believe they did. I believe that 40 years ago, when Moses told the children of Israel, they said, tonight is the night of Passover. If you remember what Moses said 40 years prior when they were in Egypt, he said, put your clothes on. He said, put your shoes on. He says, I want you to eat this Passover meal, but eat it with your shoes on your feet and the clothes on your back, because before the night's over, we're out of here. And that's exactly what they got. The lamb was in their mouth and they're out the door. I can't even sit down and have a meal and you're rushing me out the door. And they rushed out of that door. Some of them were alive, not all of them, but some of them were alive in Egypt. Some of them were underneath the age of 20. Their parents ran them out of their house with their shoes on their feet, their jacket on their back, and 40 years later, in the plains of Moab, they got the same shoes on their feet and the same clothes on their back. Yes. Moses says, that is the power of God. He will appear to you in absolute, well, that's not a subtle way. That's a miraculous thing. That's a miraculous thing. Like, that is a power. He wants to show them again how powerful God is, which will cause them to want to renew their devotion to God when in the light of how great God is. And in the understanding, finally, they're going to have eyes to see and ears to hear and say, God has been so powerful in all my life. He's been so powerful. Now, I also believe that they did make new clothes and they did make new shoes. I do believe that also, because they had all of they had the wool from the lambs and they had the animal skins. I do believe that they also made new shoes and they made new clothes. But I think God wanted to show them that it was still him. Because sometimes you think you're the ones that bought your shoes. You think you're the ones that went to work and earned your money and bought your clothes. God says, no, it's still me. It's still me. I'm still the one who provided your clothes and your shoes. And we think we have to forsake God to take care of our needs. And we think that we're taking care of ourselves. We think we don't have time for God because we're taking care of our needs. And this is, I got my shoes and I, he says, no, you didn't. It was still me. Isn't that something? It was still me, God says. And I want you to see that. I want you to see that I loved you enough. And I don't care what you think. God don't care what you think. He's going to love you and take care of you no matter. If you think you're proud and arrogant and self-sufficient and I did it, he don't care. He still loves you and takes care of you. He'll provide for the one who sees it and provide for the one who doesn't see it. God says, I don't know if you saw me or not, but I took care of you your whole life. You never took care of yourself. You never took care of yourself. You were never alone. Sometimes you like to say that. I was all alone. If you had God, I don't care if the whole world left you, you had God. Stop crying. You had God. Like, how dare you cry? You had Almighty God. You just didn't see it. I just didn't see it. And Moses wants to show this to them, to cause them to wake up, to rise up, to know how great of a people they are and great of a God they have. And before they enter into this great land. Amen? Amen. You know, he goes on to say in reminding them, he says this, he says not only that, but he says, you have, what has he said? You have not eaten bread, nor drunk wine or similar drink, that you may know that I am the Lord God. You know they didn't have any like man-made bread because they would have had to do some farming. They were wilderness wanderers. They didn't do any farming. Where did their bread come from? Heaven. You remember the manna, right? You remember that? No, sometimes we forget that. Bread fell from the sky every day for 40 years. Bread fell from the sky. Is anybody in the house hungry tonight? Yeah, you might think you're a little hungry, but there ain't no one starving here. You can say you're destitute. God's, listen, some of you got too much going on, all right? There's plenty of food in your house. There's too much food in your house. There's enough for you and for the full of Lehigh Acres. It says they didn't know bread. They didn't have wine. No, God was not a good God. No, I didn't have any bread. I didn't have any wine. No, all you had was bread that came from heaven and water that came out of rock. That's all you had. We have no idea how powerful God has been in our life. When we thought we were so destitute that somehow we got through the day and somehow we got through the season, somehow. And you know the thing about God is, you know, sometimes you're thinking you're in a real tight season. It's not as tight as you think because we just don't see God. But at the end of it, you know what's interesting? You always forget the suffering. You always forget the pain. In the midst of it, you think you're going to die, right? And in the midst of it, you want to die, right? And then when it's all over, it's like, that wasn't so bad. I know it takes some time, but in time. Say, that wasn't so bad. And you start to thank God because he did something beautiful in your life. At the time, you are not thanking God. I don't know what you do with God. I know what I do with God sometimes in those places. In those places, I would be so destitute. I would say, God, I don't know where the heck you are. I don't know what the heck's going on. But at the end of the prayer, I would always say, but God, you are the only true thing and the only real thing in life. No matter what this hell is all around me that I don't understand, you are the only true real thing in my life and in this world. So the only one that can be wrong is me. It can't be you. It's got to be me. I just don't see and don't understand. But it is very painful. Amen? But it is very painful. And God says, he takes care of you. And then he brings them up to like the most current things. You know, remember we talked at the beginning of the series about the two great kings they destroyed? King Og, right? Well, who's the other king's name? Is he in there? King Sion. Remember who these guys were? They were the biggest, baddest dudes. They said Og was like 800 years old, 9 feet tall, the greatest warrior in all the land. He'd been destroying nations for 800 years. And when Moses and all the Israelites were going out to get him, Og said, I am going to step on you. I'm going to crush you like a gnat. You are nothing. You have no idea who I am. And legend tells us that it was Moses who went and threw a spear and killed this mighty giant. That has to be embarrassing. 120-year-old man killed this mighty, mighty warrior. Josh, Moses says, I'm going to do this one myself. Get a little something in my old age here, a little something. I remember when. So not only did God remind them of the old mercies, he reminds them of the new mercies. And God's going to start to renew them again. He's going to open up your eyes. You're going to see how mighty he is because he wants to do something really beautiful in your life. The truth of the matter is, they didn't have eyes to see and ears to hear nor hearts to perceive. God is the mighty one that has always been in your life. He is the controller of your life. He leads you in the good times. He leads you in your wanderings. You are never alone. It is only by the power of God that you have life and breath and anything that is. And even when you think life is broken and bad, you just don't see God because he's doing something beautiful in the secret places. Amen. That's right. You know, and then verse 9, let's look back at verse 9. Verse 9 says, therefore, keep the words of the covenant and do them that you may prosper. You know, it says here, you know, you want to keep the word of the Lord or to keep this word. In essence, what God is saying is, you guys are the protectors of this. God took the words of heaven, he took his mighty words, the words which he used to create the universe, the words that he used when he said, let there be light, and there was light, and let there be the sun, and there was sun, and let... He took the very power of creation, he took his words, and he gave them to the Israelites. He said, I'm going to give you my words. What are these words good for? Creating. Something only a God can do. They're good for creating. Isn't that great? You guys are all creators. What do you want to create in the earth? You have the words of God. He gave you the words. What do you think you're missing? Well, go create it. What are you crying about? He gave you his words. Go create it. Whatever you think you're missing or the earth is missing, he gave you his words, and then he said, you're the watchman of it. You're the keepers of my word. You are in charge of my words. You know, they say sometimes there's a phrase that says, what are you? Are you a thermostat or are you a thermometer? Do you just tell the temperature of the room or do you create the temperature of the room? Do you just explain what the atmosphere is in the world or do you change the atmosphere? Because sometimes we're the thermometers. We're the ones that just say, well, it's this, it's this, it's this, it's this. Okay, well, where's the thermostat? Where's the one that's going to say, well, it's going to be this?